today we are talking about the differences between whole genome sequencing and 16S metagenomics. This is the second webinar of a three-part webinar series we've done to help everyone kind of understand how we see food safety genomics, next generation sequencing, and the applications that are out there today. So today's webinar is kind of a high-level overview of the differences between some of the metagenomics, the data that might be in there, how you might use those types of technologies in a processing facility, and the types of questions you'll be able to answer based on the technology. So the next webinar is January 11th at 2 p.m. You will see the registration link in a follow-up email to this webinar. If you missed the first case study, that's on YouTube. You can also find that on our webpage, or copy and paste it, or write that down from the slide that you see in front of you. That one went into a deep dive and an unveiling of some of the different nuances that you might see from a metagenomics spoilage investigation. So as we kind of get started, we really like to break down food safety genomics and next generation sequencing into three big buckets. The first one is pathogen outbreak. This is where whole genome sequencing and other applications reside around the identification, antimicrobial resistance, all of that kind of falls into one bucket. Microbiome research and spoilage and changes in microflora, shelf life analysis, we kind of put that in another bucket. And the last one is food fraud, so your meat species identification, GMO testing, all of those fall in that last bucket. And these are three big areas that exist within next generation sequencing. And so if you look at it like that, you can start to break out some of the data analysis and what that might look like. So the first one we get into is whole genome sequencing. Whole genome sequencing is kind of like determining and comparing the genetic fingerprint of a microorganism. And I think there are some limitations to that analogy, but I think it's a good starting point. This technology is replacing pulse field gel electrophoresis. And what you're seeing today is basically the convergence of three big areas. One of them is the sequencing technologies have evolved. Bioinformatics has increased alongside of the sequencing technologies, and then big data. And these three technology spaces have kind of come together today to how the agencies are using whole genome sequencing. And they're using it to replace pulse field gel electrophoresis. So what you see there is a number of different bands from an old PFGE slide. And what this means is using a genetics fingerprint, it's easier to analyze and interpret and do this on a larger scale. The other thing that you can kind of see, if you can count the number of bands on some of those similar type isolates on the right-hand side of your screen, you can imagine that the resolution between those 10 to 15 20 bands that you see could be limited. With whole genome sequencing, we gain a lot of resolution because we're looking at millions and millions of base pairs within a bacterial sequence. So if you're not really sure how this is all kind of coming together, we'll try and address that in this slide. So there's three agencies in play here. One of them is the CDC. The other two are the FDA and the USDA. One of the things that is happening is specimens and isolates are generated in the public health labs. So if somebody gets sick, those are sent off to the lab, whole genome sequencing is performed, and that goes into through the CDC into genome tracker. At the same time, the FDA and USDA continually look throughout the supply chain with food, environmental, some of the swabathons, generating isolates and feeding that back into the same genome tracker. And what they're trying to do is match up organisms from sick individuals to somewhere in the supply chain. Conceptually, what this is really trying to do is it's trying to change how quickly the agencies can address public health concerns. So you can kind of see traditionally through an epidemiological investigation, you might not find an outbreak until later on in the event. And this is supposed to bring new data, monitoring, etc., to speed up those finding those issues. And this is actually coming to fruition. So if you look at, and I think some of you have seen this slide before, This is from the CDC, and you've got four different areas to kind of think about. So there's pre-PulseNet, the early PulseNet, and then the Listeria Initiative, and then whole genome sequencing. And there's a kind of a key takeaway here is between the Listeria Initiative, between 2004 to 2013, your average outbreak solved per year was 2.6, but the size of that outbreak is 5.5. Those numbers on the number of outbreaks are increasing under whole genome sequencing, but the number of people within an outbreak goes down. And what that's telling us, and this kind of goes alongside with what we were talking about, why this is replacing PFGE, is the resolution of whole genome sequencing as compared to PFGE is much greater. And that works twofold. It also helps you eliminate previous isolates that would have been considered the same, and it easily identifies those as not being the same. So if you're, this is an important distinction when thinking about some of the other technologies in the sequencing space. So with whole genome sequencing, we're still doing an enrichment. You still have to go through an isolation step, picking a colony, go through a DNA library prep, put that on the sequencer. You're lining up all those A, T, C's, and G's within the Illumina MiSeq. You build that genome and put it all together, and then you compare that against other isolates either in your data set or within Genome Tracker, etc. So I think one of the things that gets lost in some of the other whole genome sequencing presentations is how you really structure the data and leverage that into answering real questions. We've got two representations here. They're both from a European whole genome sequencing publication. I think they illustrate something very important, and that is how you structure the data can help you answer different types of questions. And so the way that this is shown is there's different clusters of isolates based on additional information within the data set on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side might be something that you'd see in a phylogenetic tree, and all you're looking for within that analysis is how close two strains are. So within more complex data sets, you can do different types of analyses. And then here's another example of this. This is a principal component analysis. And I think this does a nice example. What we're looking for here, and I'm going to get the highlighter out, are these groups of samples. So here's one, two, and three. So in this example, we've got a number of organisms that are kind of aligned very similarly genetically, a smaller group up here, and then there's an outlier on the right-hand side. Percentages are just kind of a relative measure of how different they are. And when you start overlaying things like environmental zones, dates or key changes to the process, different raw materials or production cycles, that's when some of these information start to jump out to say, well, this organism here on the right-hand side, we need to understand what that represents, what it's coming from, et cetera. So we go back and see that that's sample four, and all of a sudden we've got a way to leverage whole genome sequencing data to give ourselves a better resolution to a problem we're trying to solve. So that leads us into, you know, the practical questions that you might want to be asking with whole genome sequencing. One of the first ones is, are you dealing with a resident organism or continued introduction? And I think this is a very important question that is often overlooked, because how you would address one root cause is very different than the other. So understanding if you have a transient strain or a resident strain can really help you shape and form your corrective actions or actions around mitigating this problem. The other is looking at the data sets in a broader context. So do you know where these organisms are coming from? If you are going to leverage an outside database like Genome Tracker and NCBI, are there other matches in the data sets with either different supply chains or different verticals or ingredient types? Some of that metadata can really add some power to your WGS analysis. The last one is, there are there organisms you're finding today the same as that you've seen before? And what this is really getting into is, if you do have a continued introduction, are your methods and your preventive controls appropriate for what you're trying to do, and are they working over time? And so what this might look like is, if you see the same genetic pattern over a long period of time, that would tell you that you're not addressing it, and you're not mitigating your, let's say, listeria introduction. If you're seeing new patterns and they're going away and new ones are coming in, that just might tell you that you have a supply issue or a concern, an input into your system that needs to be addressed, but you are addressing it on a routine basis. Your preventive controls are working. And I think this is the type of data that the agencies are looking for based on some of the public meetings that we've attended. So there's still a couple of big questions that remain unanswered. So the big one is the statute of limitations. And what we mean on that is if an agency or a regulatory body or yourself find an isolate, does that data have an expiry date? Is it good forever? And I think what we've heard so far is that it's context dependent. So listeria growing in a cold environment probably has that data from 5 years ago is more relevant than, let's say, a feedlot in northern Texas because of the organism, its rate of change, etc. Which is good because I think the agencies and from what we've heard from public meetings are starting to think about that. On that same type of vein is beyond listeria monocytogenes, are there differences and nuances with salmonella and E. coli? The genetic mutation rates, we know there's published data out there that they are different between listeria and salmonella, and even the amount of mobile and extra genetic material in an E. coli is different than listeria. So there are nuances between the pathogen types, and I'm not sure if we really understand that completely, and it kind of comes through in some of the data that, you know, listeria monocytogenes has a SNP different tolerance of around 5 versus salmonella is closer to 20. And one of the things that we have continued to hear is that epidemiology will play a role in a food safety recall. And so these are all different pieces of evidence that are all important in a food safety audit or a recall. So that's what we have on whole genome sequencing. Hopefully you've got a good understanding of how it's being used and what the data looks like and what type of questions you might be asking. And we are going to stay on time today, so we're going to briefly kind of talk about some of the other areas. And one of the key things I hope you walk away with from this webinar with is the understanding that next generation sequencing is this big umbrella of technology, and whole genome sequencing and this ID and relatedness application the agencies are using is a subset of this big umbrella. Okay, and I think this was in the last webinar, just to kind of recap, whole genome sequencing, we're still doing enrichment, we're generating an isolate, and then we're going through that process. 16S metagenomics and shotgun metagenomics both look at product or environmental samples or raw materials without any type of enrichment. 16S is looking for a specific gene that helps identify different bacteria. Shotgun metagenomics looks at everything, and there are some trade-offs and some positives to both sets of technologies, and that's a fun topic for another day. And to put this into some context, hopefully this will help, whole genome sequencing, we're looking at one isolate with maybe a 3 to 4 million base pair assembly. Metagenomics, we're looking at maybe 50 to 100 different organisms. The 16S gene, we're looking at the V4, and that's, you know, 450 base pairs, so maybe 45,000, and you've got lots and lots of copies of that. So it's a smaller subset. And then for shotgun metagenomics, what you're looking is you're sequencing everything, all the DNA that's in a sample, and so you can your order of magnitude goes up significantly with shotgun metagenomics, which is, I think, kind of helps people understand the differences in the types of data. And so we'll jump into 16S metagenomics. If you're not familiar with that, we're taking in some samples, we're doing the extraction, we're doing a PCR of one specific region of the gene, and then we do the data analysis. And this is very, very, very different than a phylogenetic tree. What we're looking at on the x-axis are different samples, different colors correlate to different bacteria. The size of the color within a bar represents the relative abundance. We're doing this to answer things like what organisms are present within a sample that are not supposed to be there, and where are they coming from. So in the case study, and this is just as one of the slides from the case study, we found out that there was a particular type of organism that was coming out from a hot water bath, and we used this sequencing technology to go in and look for where that was specifically coming from. And we kind of vectored it in through the different sampling protocols. So there is one another application we should go down this list. So from 16S, we can start thinking about targeted amplicon sequencing. One area that we're doing that today, which is pretty interesting, is Salmonella serotyping. And what we do is we're looking at four very specific genes, H1, H2, O group, and ISR. That correlates to about 4,500 base pairs. And you can, if you think about the 3 to 5 million that are sequenced within a whole genome, it's a very, very small subset that we are able to leverage to identify the serotype. And because it's a nonspecific amplification, we can get 1,500 to maybe 2,000, we think, of the different serotypes of Salmonella. And because we're only looking at a small section of the genome, it's 3 to 5 business days. And you can see that this is an interesting application where if we're looking for specific gene targets of a complex microorganism and we know what we're looking for, we can quickly sequence them and generate some interesting data. If you are familiar with traditional serology, there are some limitations in terms of human interpretation and expression of the flagellar proteins. And one advantage over that with sequencing is we don't have to have the proteins expressed in order to identify them. So just to kind of recap, Neogen is offering some of these services out of our Lincoln, Nebraska facility. Today we've got NeoSeq S-Tech identification, Salmonella serotyping, 16S metagenomics for spoilage identification, meat species identification, and then whole genome sequencing. We're progressing to be able to offer that in a more meaningful way. So we like to save 5 to 10 minutes for questions. And if you aren't following us on social media, please feel free. The information's on the screen. And with that, we will open it up to questions. So just a question on the use of database and genome tracker. So if you recall, when we talked about the different questions you can ask with whole genome sequencing, a lot of those are database dependent. So if you have a number of samples within one facility over time, you can begin to look at those analysis and do transient versus resident strains. If you want to look at the broader context of what's there, you should be looking at either the NCBI or genome tracker. Because those are continually updating, they get stronger over time. And that's where I might start. You do not have to submit a isolate data to do the analysis with genome tracker. That can be done offline, so the proprietary aspect of a isolate genetic information can be kept outside of genome tracker. Thank you so much for giving us a few minutes of your time. We're going to get you out of here about 5 minutes early. If you can, join us for the January webinar looking at using sequencing over time to do formulation analysis and microbiome studies on products. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me directly or drop us an email on our webpage. Thanks again, and we'll see you next time.